So you're trying to say some companies might have been overpriced at 60 and all they did was go to 50 and say, big deal. So you're trying to find companies you liked anyway. Right now you liked them and now they've had a haircut. Mm-hmm. That's what you would do. Not a stock that went from overpriced to fairly priced. Something that was fairly priced at the start of this exercise and then had a very, you know, a 5-for-4 sale. You know.
It's highly regarded as one of Wall Street's legendary money managers. He ran Fidelity's Magellan Fund from 77 to 90. At the end of his 13-year helm, it was up over 2,700% and had become the world's largest mutual fund. He remains on the board of trustees at the Fidelity Group and is vice chairman of Fidelity Management and Research. His new CD-ROM is called The Stock Shop with Peter Lynch, and its strategies to invest in the stock market with confidence. All the profits for this go to charity, I think. He joins me now to talk about the remarkable record volume day on Wall Street and other matters of investing, and I am very pleased to have him back at this table. Welcome back.
Hey, Charlie, good to see you.
Now, smart of me to schedule you on a day like this. 3 months ago, I said, when do you want Lynch to come in? Right. I said, let's get him on Tuesday. Something's going to happen in the market that week, and so here we are.
Glad to be here.
Explain to me what's going on.
Well, we had a huge run. I mean, the market was 4,000 just, you know, 2.5 years ago.
Yeah.
And it ran up to 8,300 in August. And, you know, like any big rally, sometimes it backs off. I mean, it's healthy. In fact, I mean, I'd rather have gone down 1,000 points than gone to 12,000. If you look at Japan, Japan went from 5,000 to 15,000 on their Dow. And it was fairly priced at 15,000 on earnings and everything else. Mm-hmm. Then it went to 40,000. And that caused 7 years of inflated real estate, people overspending. And basically, they've been in a recession for 5 or 6 years because their market went up too high. I mean, if the market goes up too high, I mean, if the market goes too high, you're discounting earnings 7, 8, 10 years out. There's a relationship.
So everything is overpriced.
Yeah, and that doesn't help anything. The market since World War II has sold between 10 times earnings and 20 times earnings. If you look at the Dow Jones or the S&P 500, if you add up all the companies and take the earnings, you say there's a relationship. And it follows. McDonald's earnings have been terrific the last 30 years, and the stock's been terrific. There's a direct relationship. So the earnings of the S&P 500 have been between this range of 10 and 20. We were just about to go over the 20, which is the high end of the P.E. range. There wasn't a lot of room left on the P.E.
So P.E. of 20 is the top of how high it should ever be.
Right. It's been over there only a few times ever over 20. And that's when usually inflation's about zero. In the early 60s, when inflation was about zero, we got a little bit over 20. Now we have a very low inflation rate. So if you usually have subtracted inflation from 20, you've had the P.E. of the market. That's been a pretty good ratio. When inflation was 12%, you remember in the early 80s, we had an 8 or 9 P.E. of the market.
So Dr. Lynch says all of this has been good for us?
Well, like I'm telling you, it would not have been helpful.
It's like a purgative or something.
I never thought I'd ever wish for the market to not go up dramatically. But let's argue the market went to 16,000 tomorrow.
Yeah.
Basically, there's earnings behind companies.
Okay, but I'm not arguing that. I know that's true.
And that would be crazy.
And stock market price ought to be dictated by earnings and earnings performance and future earnings potential.
That's right.
I got that. Even I got that.
Right.
Now, let's just take this for me.
Sure. Was
the decline yesterday, in a sense, it let off some of this overvaluation. The market was even overvalued at where it was.
Right.
And by letting it off, then we got back to what was reasonable.
Well, yeah, I would say fairly priced. Maybe for the larger companies, they're now okay. There might be some small companies. I mean, we've had 3,000 companies come public the last 4 years. That's two a business day.
Yeah.
Some of those companies have gone down dramatically. And that's sort of a research zone that average people in the stock shop, that's what we can find. Some people know a lot about this, 10,000 public companies. A lot of them are very attractive. No one's following them. And there's lots of people following IBM.
Well, that's
lots
how you
of people
got rich
Microsoft.
Following companies that nobody else followed.
Right. I'd like to go to see companies with unions or companies in trouble or companies that no one looks
hotels
at.
Hotels that had nice beds.
Well,
and,
yeah, and you have to look at a lot of them. You look at
pantyhose your wife wore. I remember this story.
Oh, okay, you got Pier 1 Imports. My wife found that one too. But you have to look at 20 to find one. It's just you don't go to the mall and find the stock. I mean, you have to say, my God, this sounds like it's good. Then you have to do some steps. You have to do an organized method. People are careful when they buy a toaster. They do some research.
But they don't do it with stock. They call up the broker or they see somebody at lunch and they say, man, I got this hot stock.
Yep.
And you run right out and you spend $5,000, investors.
Yep. Or even worse, they put an option in International Data WAC. They don't even own International Data WAC. So they have a 90-day play.
But it's Bill like said it was good and they make a lot of money.
Right. And it's like a casino.
Yeah.
So it's like a casino. You get the same results as if there's more paperwork.
All right. But just stay with me in terms of people who are bedazzled by what's happened.
Right.
If you look at yesterday and you look at today,
right,
nothing has happened in the fundamentals of economics of any company.
Right.
But their stock may have gone down 10% yesterday and up 5% right. today.
One modest point, though. I mean, every time you have to get a memory. It's like it gets very cold in the winter in some parts of the country. You get a memory that winter's coming. Something did really happen in Southeast Asia. I mean, those
did. Was that the cause of what happened in this market?
Well, I think so. That was the reminder saying, by the way, you know, profits can go down. I mean, there is a downside.
But why was that the cause? I mean, did what's happening in Southeast Asia affect the earnings potential of all these companies you're talking about?
It did.
Because they can't sell their products there?
In a small way. No, because those economies have been growing double-digit. And all of a sudden now, they're going to, because of bank problems, because they're overfinanced, they're underleveraged. I mean, they're going to have to draw on their belts. Those parts. And then people said, "Whoa, maybe that'll become. It'll happen. China's now the fourth largest economy in the world. Maybe China can go in recession." So this sort of woke people. It was like a wake-up call, saying, "Whoa, maybe there's a chance earnings are going to go down." I mean, this is not a big deal for the United States. When Mexico went down, much more important. But it sort of said people.
Why was it much more important?
Well, Mexico's much more important
to
the United States. Than Thailand is, or the Philippines. Their economy is very important to us. They're a big consumer, very important. They're our neighbor, a lot of people there. That's a very important. When that went down, that affected Latin America was more important. So the recession of 1990, but it sort of reminded people. They'd say, wait a second, there is a downside. We've had 9 recessions since World War II. We'll have other ones.
Tell me what took place overnight between yesterday at the close of market and today at the beginning of market. What were the guys that you used to work with saying to each other at Fidelity, and what were the people you know saying?
Right.
For example, IBM made a decision to buy back their stock, and that presented some kind of push on the market, and their stock went up 6 points.
Well, one thing you're trying to do is
that's
say, of all these public companies out there, here's a company I really like. The fundamentals are terrific. Their earnings are doing well. Their competitors are doing poorly. I think this company's doing terrific. And all of a sudden, the stock might have gone from 40 to 30 because of this decline. That would say, wow, here's a chance to buy it. So you're trying to say some companies might have been overpriced at 60 and all they did was go to 50 and say, big deal. So you're trying to find companies you liked anyway. Right now you liked them. And now they've had a haircut. Mm-hmm. That's what you would do. Not a stock that went from overpriced to fairly priced. Something that was fairly priced at the start of this exercise and then had a very, you know, a 5-for-4 sale. You know.
If you had been managing the Magellan Fund this morning, you would have been buying like crazy?
I would have been researching like crazy. I would have been saying, which companies are the same story? Is there anything really happening? This is a non-event for them. They're still doing well. Even if we have a recession, there's nothing to do with them. And that's the kinds I would try to buy. But let's say if a company, just think of it, this as being, you say to yourself, I think this company's going to earn something in the future. If it's already discounting that, if it's selling at a huge multiple, you say, it has to work. And then it's only going to stay even. So you have to say to yourself, if I'm right, how much am I going to make? If I'm wrong, how much am I going to lose? That's the risk-reward ratio. In Stock Shop, we talk about, if I'm right, I hope I'm going to double, triple my money. If I'm wrong, may I lose 30, 40%. That's a favorable ratio. We say, if I'm right, the stock's not going to go up. It's already discounting terrific things. If discounting terrific things are already in the stock, I don't want to own
it. So this morning you get up and you go in and you look at those companies that fit
that you know something about. You have to have an itch. I mean, let's say the cement industry goes from crummy to semi-crummy to fairly good. The stocks are going north.
Right.
You're going to make money. That's the industry you know. What if you know the publishing industry? Some people have an itch. You work. I mean, what if you last 30 years you worked in the restaurant industry? You would have seen Taco Bell.
Right.
You would have seen Sbarro's.
Right.
You would have seen Pizza Hut. You would have seen Chili's. You would have seen these companies doing very well. You should have bought those instead of trying to buy biotechnology stocks you know nothing about. I mean, I know nothing about local area networking. A lot of people are buying this Cisco. They're buying the equipment, saying, we're going to root together all these peripherals and put together the servers.
Well, but that's not a bad buy because they own a huge percentage of their market.
No, but they're saying only a few people had that. I said, my God, if it works for us, other people will try it, then colleges will try it, high schools will try it, then they'll go overseas. They knew they were early in the ball game.
Right.
And they should have been buying that company instead of out buying something they don't know anything about, some oil drilling company. I mean, people have this tendency to always buy something they don't. All you need is a few good stocks a decade.
But this is your song. This has been your song for a long time.
No,
only buy what you know.
No, but people are waking up in the morning and say, there's 5,000 companies out there. Which one should I buy? The average person ought to be able to follow 4 or 5 companies. They ought to be able to lecture on them. They understand the companies. And this forces you. This tool says to you, write down the story.
All right, but you keep saying this. The Stock Shop is what? What is it? This is a CD-ROM that you plug into your CD-ROM play through your PC, and you come up with what?
Well, also, it's a data stream that you can update information on 5,000 or 6,000 companies, right like that. You can get 10 years of financial data, 10 years of income statements, 10 years of inventory. So you can get updates on all these companies.
But that's what you get on a Bloomberg terminal.
No, but it's only right now. And you know, it doesn't pick 50 data points. It doesn't go over 5 years. This, on the companies you want to look at, it'll give you all the information.
Out of this?
It costs $6.95 a month in addition, and you get a free trial.
Oh, I see.
You get a free trial. We get a cut rate deal, and you can also buy it. You can get it from Fidelity for special programs. But this is something, this will help you update it. So you can say, this is a company I want to look at, and I want to see what are the cash looks like. And if you don't understand what cash is, if you don't understand what debt is, I always said, let's say you're looking at companies that are doing poorly. They're not doing very well. Why don't you buy the one that has $300 million in cash instead of the one that's almost bankrupt? I mean, a lot of companies are selling at $2 or $3 a share. They might be losing $10
million. That's a no-brainer, isn't
it? But people don't do it.
And well, they don't do it because they don't know how to do the research.
Well, at least you can look up the balance sheet and say, listen, they got $300 million in cash. They're losing $10 million a quarter. They'll be okay. Yeah. This other company's got no cash, $700 million in debt. They're about to blow taps.
But you're telling every small investor in America anyway they ought to invest in a mutual fund, aren't you?
I'm telling you can do both. You could be investing in mutual funds, and occasionally you should be able to find a stock that's going to make a difference in your life.
If it's an industry you know something about.
Industry or a local company. I mean, there's a lot of people that they sell the Quinta Motorins in Texas. They said, my God, I mean, there are a lot of people have seen local companies. Friendly's, there's been companies come along locally. The people that made St. Jude Medical made a lot of money for people.
What was that motel you stayed in and then you went and bought a bunch of it?
Yeah, La Quinta Motorins.
Was that La Quinta? That's what it was, right. You stayed overnight there.
And I also got advice from somebody that was a competitor of this. It was a Holiday Inn guy saying, this guy, boy, they're killing us. They're tough, you know. So that you get a lot of information. Don't throw it away.
All right, before you go. So what, you buy this thing and is it going to charity or not?
Well, all my profits, I mean, Houghton Mifflin is the person marketing this, and they're keeping some profits.
You haven't made them a charitable company
yet. And the company at the company that's selling it, if you go to Borders or you go to Crop USA, everything I've done, all my books and on this, my wife and I contribute everything to charity.
Is this because you made a bunch of money, and so therefore what you do now you want to be?
That's part of it, but also, even if I had made a bunch of money, I'd like to see people do a better job. These are people, I mean,
Your crusade is to influence the investing habits of America?
Have them do a better job. If they're not ready to do it properly, they shouldn't do it. And you used to be able to retire, and you get half of your last year's salary. Yeah. You'd have a pension. You could rely on that. Now you have to do it for yourself. Some people are presented, they're let go, or they're early retirement, and they're given $500,000, and they say, this is it. This is your retirement, lady. You've got to take care of it now. And some people have lost all that money in options in the last 3 months.
So what you're saying to people today about the future of the market over the near term is what? What's your feeling?
Take a coin out and flip it. I have no idea what the next 1,000 points is going to do. The next 6,000 points is going to be up. The next 14,000 points is going to be up. The next 20,000 points is going to be up.
But you don't know where the next 1,000 is going to be. It could be down, could be up.
And it's futile to try and guess it. Corporate profits will be a lot higher 10 years from now. They'll be a lot higher 20 years from now. That's what you could rely on. Microsoft didn't exist 20 years ago. Staples didn't exist 20 years ago. Federal Express didn't exist 20 years ago. New companies will come along. That's what makes
stocks didn't exist 20 years ago.
That's what makes Amgen has $2 billion drugs. They didn't exist 20 years ago. New companies have come along. That's what makes this country work. You got to keep your eyes open.
Okay, is the game over in Asia?
No, God, no. Are you kidding? Some of these countries have a 56% savings rate. They have a high literacy rate. The game's not over.
But have they lost something?
Well, they're going to have to. Of their lending, they got carried away. They're going to have to, step back, figure it out, and go ahead. It's certainly not over in Asia. No way.
So emerging markets is still a big deal.
Right, big deal.
What about all the criticism of derivatives and the impact they have had?
That's a little complicated for me. All I know is, I mean, I don't know about derivatives.
It's complicated for you?
It's way over my head. I've never bought an option in my life. Time's on your side when you own a stock. I don't know about putting, 3% down and buying a future and a strap and a straddle. That's way over my head. Can't deal with that.
Is that right?
Let somebody else deal with it, yeah.
All right, so you're optimistic about the future of the American economy. Earnings potential for most well-run companies will do all right.
But people have to understand we've had 9 recessions since World War II. We'll have other recessions.
But we're not in one now.
But we may have one in the future, and don't get worried about it. It will have one. Sometime it'll happen, and no one will tell you when it's going to happen.
Won't the fundamentals tell you?
No, you'll find out after the fact. All of a sudden you'll notice orders slowing, prices get more competitive, then earnings are down. I mean, usually you find out after that. Everybody's insane we're going to have a recession for 5 years. It just hasn't happened.
It's great to see you. I hope you'll come back anytime, Peter.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.